Hello from Rappel Cybersecurity. Welcome to the UNECE 155 training. As you might remember from the ISO SAE 21434 training series, we had promised to make a dedicated presentation on UNECE 155, and this is it. The UNECE organization, context of UNECE 155 regulation, and an overview of contents will be presented. Some points to remind before we start. This presentation is not intended to be used for obtaining a legal compliance with UNECE 155 regulation because this requires a detailed planning of activities guided and audited by authorized bodies of a country. Compliance with a regulation is much more demanding than a standard because several standards, best practices, rules, guidelines are digged deep for this purpose. As usual, we try to put references and links to all information that we present for curious readers. Feel free to distribute or display this presentation as long as the content is not altered. It is highly recommended to view the ISO SAE 21434 training series before this presentation. The table provided here is an example to highlight certain cybersecurity roles in an organization. Please pay attention to the cybersecurity manager, who is supposed to work with both project and independent teams. The titles on the slide will be presented. Attention! Unlike ISO SAE 21434 training series, we will not navigate through the clauses of the regulation. All UN regulatory texts are free access. The United Nations Economic Commission for Europe, UNECE, is one of the five United Nations regional commissions administered by the Economic Social Council. It was established in 1947 to help rebuild post-war Europe, develop economic activity, and strengthen economic relations among European countries and between Europe and the rest of the world. Despite the complexity of this period, numerous consensus were reached and numerous harmonization and standardization agreements were done. Since the early 1990s, UNECE has focused on assisting the countries of Central and Eastern Europe, Caucasus, and Central Asia with their transition process and their integration into the global economy. Today, UNECE, with its 56 member states, provides a multilateral platform for policy dialogue, the development and international legal instruments, standards, best practices, and economic and technical expertise. The Inland Transport Committee, ITC, was set up in 1947 under UNECE. In the same year when UNECE was founded, to support the reconstruction of transport infrastructures in post-war Europe. Over the years, it has specialized in a harmonized and sustainable development of all modes of inland transport. WP29 is one of the 18 working parties of UNECE under ITC, and its role is to work on three agreements shown with yellow boxes on the right, which are the agreements of 1958, 1998, and 1997. UNECE 155 regulation adopts the 1958 agreement. You may see the map on the upper right. The 58 countries or the contracting parties that are part of this agreement as of today. The work coordination of WP29 is done by the steering committee on the right. Underneath, in blue boxes, you can see six subsidiary working groups of WP29. Here, the GR prefix is coming from the French acronym Groupe de Rapporteur, which is the equivalent of working party. Under the GR that we are concerned, the GRVA, the automated, autonomous, and connected vehicles, there are several informal working groups. You can see them on the right. The one who is responsible for the UNECE 155 regulation is the one highlighted in yellow, cybersecurity and software updates. Well, that's almost the complete hierarchy of the UN R155 regulation. You may consult the links at the bottom of the slide for more information about the organization and its history. All the regulations that are annexed to 1958 agreement must have the scope and the provisions listed in the slide. In other words, these are the common high-level objectives that shall be ensured by these regulations, but only if the regulations are entirely applied. We won't go into the details of these items. However, it's important to know what we should expect from UNECE regulations. This information is a bit too deep for the project members, but it is a must-have for the governance officers of the company. It might be a good exercise to make links between the clauses of UNR 155 and these provisions. For me, the most hitting provision is the one highlighted in yellow, the mutual recognition. As we will see in the upcoming slides, this makes a both positive and negative impact on the adoption of UNR 155 by nations. On the slide, you might see the 1958 agreement map on the right and the Venn diagram on the left that shows the number of nations who adopted the UNR 155 regulation. At the top of the Venn diagram, there are United Nations member states, which cover almost the entire world, 193 out of 195. Under UN, there are 56 UNECE members. The ones who have adopted the 1958 agreement is 44. On the other hand, there are 14 non-UNECE nations who have adopted this agreement. If you come to UNR 155 regulation, the number drops to 55 as 3 non-UNECE member states who signed the 1958 agreement did not adopt the UNR 155 regulation. Just to remind, there are 108 regulations appended to this agreement and UNR 155 is just one of it. Another detail that we need to mention is, once a regulation is officially released, the nations are not obliged to accept all clauses inside a regulation. So, they might very well declare their exceptions. For example, Japan indicated that they will apply the UNR 155 regulation to vehicles with OTA update feature 2 years after the dates indicated in the regulation text, that is 2024 for new vehicle types and 2026 for all vehicle types. 1958 versus 1998 agreements. Are you surprised not to find USA, Canada, China, India, and several other nations in the 1958 agreement map? No, you shouldn't be. International relations are never simple. Each state or country has its own authority and sovereignty. Being a member of an organization like UNECE only does not automatically enforce the endorsement of regulatory text diffused by that organization. If a country signs a treaty or an agreement, fully or partially, and at its own will, only then that text will be rendered mandatory for that country. US and Canada follow a system of self-certification and thus found it difficult to implement the mutual recognition approvals in 1958 agreement. In 1995, the 1958 agreement was revised to include a self-certification process. However, it did not work. Therefore, US, Japan, and European community prepared a new text to develop a global agreement for the harmonization of vehicle regulations with the objective of involving countries from all over the world. This was a success because US, Canada, India, China, and several other nations signed the agreement. However, almost entire Africa, South America, Middle East, and a part of South Asia are still not participating. So what made this possible? What are the most important differences between 1958 and 1998 agreements? First of all, unlike the 1958 agreement, 1998 agreement does not call for mutual recognition of approvals or certification. The mutual recognition in 1958 agreement says that all contracting parties who have signed the same regulation will recognize each other's approvals. This significantly reduces the time and costs of design, manufacture and approval, and entry into service. On the other hand, it reduces the flexibility and introduces a dependency which is not tolerated by all nations. The UNGTORs are technical regulations being established under the 1998 agreement and will not refer to a type approval or certification procedure as opposed to 1958 agreement regulations. These GTRs are mostly derived from 1958 agreement regulations. For interested readers, there is currently no GTR that implements UNR 155 requirements and there is no plan to create one. Particularly for US, we cannot really speak about the existence of a vehicle cybersecurity regulation, but rather a best practices document edited by NHTSA, the National Highway Traffic Safety Administration. The vehicle cybersecurity regulatory texts research for nations like China, India, and several nations who hasn't adopted UNR 155 is left to readers to find out. Nevertheless, if you compare the ISO SAE 21434 coverage map at the upper right corner with both agreements, we see that ISO SAE 21434 compliance is globally a very valuable investment that is very likely to pay itself. How to comply with UNR 155? UNR 155 compliance process starts with addressing an application to the type approval authority in the contracting party. The scope of the type approval is identified with respect to vehicle type and categories listed in the regulation, and also the market targeted by the manufacturer. As you have seen in previous slides, UNR 155 compliance opens the way for significant opportunities for the manufacturer, but does not cover the whole world. Therefore, the manufacturer should make its decisions and investments intelligently. UNR 155 compliance for manufacturers requires significant effort and budget. 2 to 3 years is barely sufficient with the presence of adequate resources. The next step will be the approval of the CSMS. It requires implementation and integration of the cybersecurity processes that ensure managed cybersecurity risk throughout the entire life cycle of the product and the supply chain. This is very well explained in ISO SAE 21434, and audit criteria are available in ISO PAS 5112. An audit report is generated at this step that shows how the maturity of the CSMS as well as the gaps and the action plan if it's not successful. Generally, the next step, which is the technical validation of the cybersecurity at product level, will not be possible if CSMS is not approved. The technical validation will consist of literally testing the cybersecurity features of the product with respect to the threats that are listed in the UNR 155 and X5. In fact, this will also show whether the CSMS, which is approved in the previous phase, is respected or not. The work products that are created during the development and testing according to ISO SAE 21434 will accompany the cybersecurity validation. Once the tests are completed, a report will be generated that gathers all evidences. The last phase is the assessment of the findings. As you might remember from the ISO SAE 21434 training, the cybersecurity assessment must be carried out independently. Therefore, it must not be the same entity that performs the cybersecurity validation. If the assessment is positive, the type approval is granted as planned in the initial phase. Now the manufacturer may directly bring the approved product to the market, which mutually recognize the type approval without further testing. UNR 155 has two main parts: the CSMS, cybersecurity management system at organization level, and cybersecurity at vehicle level. On the left, you can see the cybersecurity management system that includes the requirements for the organizational level cybersecurity processes. These processes are required to perform the cybersecurity activities under discipline and obtain the required outcomes at project level. You may see here different cybersecurity processes mentioned in the regulation. On the right, you can see the main activities related to the CSMS process. Of course, each activity must have an outcome that is a work product and it shall be in required quality. The two main parts, in fact, are in line with the previous slide that briefly explains the certification process. UNR 155 regulation, like all UNECE documentation, is open access. Therefore, an overview of chapters will not be presented. Interested readers are invited to browse through the regulation and the interpretation document, which are available in the UNECE website. You may see the links at the bottom of the slide here. Next steps and recommendations. We will have different recommendations for suppliers and OEMs in the slide. I will start with OEMs. At first, it is crucial to identify the market and the regulatory or any binding text text applicable. It seems trivial to get this information online. However, we should keep in mind that regulatory texts are constantly being updated. In addition, the contracting parties are evolving, so the best practice would be to follow minutes of meetings, amendments, and all updates of working groups and commissions, not to miss any important information. For example, Category L was recently added to the UNR 155 scope, however, it will be enforced starting from 2029. The European Cybersecurity Resilience Act is now under discussion and it will certainly have a major impact on all connected systems in the future. To cope with all of these regulations, standards, practices, which in different countries and regions, the OEMs are recommended to follow an intelligent strategy to optimize effort. A good example is the GSR2 regulation. Even if it's a safety regulation, it obliges the establishment of a CSMS, the Cybersecurity Management System, before July 2024 for all vehicle types. The suppliers. Suppliers should follow all recommendations for OEMs because they are their customers. It is generally required to set the cybersecurity compliance deadline of suppliers 6 to 12 months before the deadlines of the OEM. To be honest, 6 months is very tight, and it will not be sufficient for complex electronic units because in most cases, suppliers are not able to get the inputs that they expect from OEMs due to parallel activities. This causes us to make assumptions, those which are clarified only in the late phases of the development, while the solution is identifying the project level risks at the beginning and managing them till the end. These lists are not exhaustive, of course. Having a quality consultancy service is a key and might resolve several problems quickly in most cases. And the last thing, the early bird wins. Why? Being one of the first entities that look for the compliance with a new cybersecurity text is always an advantage because authorities are also supposed to be at the learning phase at that time. So the compliance activity is expected to go in a more collaborative fashion than usual. So hurry up for the new regulations and standards. Here comes the questions to test yourself. The answers can be found in the slides. Good luck. Thanks for listening. Don't forget to subscribe to this channel and follow the LinkedIn page not to miss any important updates. See you soon.